Welcome everyone. In this video, we will learn about regulatory systems that transduce the environmental signals to cell and it results in synthesis of virulence factors. Basically, we will be studying when the virulence factor is produced. So, it is in response to the environmental signals. So, we will see what are these different types of environmental signals and how the synthesis is occurring and how it is regulated. Okay, so first we will see what is a virulence factor. Virulence factor is any structure or a substance that aid in pathogenicity to a pathogen to help establish a infection. Okay, so structures and substances means any structure such as pili, flagella or substances such as toxins. Okay, so what happens, these virulence factors, when they are produced, they are exported to the cell surface or beyond. If it is a pili, it will be exported to the surface. Okay, so pili are on surface, and if it is a flagella, it is also will be on the surface of pathogen. If it is an enzyme or toxin, it will be exported beyond the surface, it will be injected into the host, or it will be released in the environment. Okay, so this is how virulence factors work. And most importantly, they are not constitutively produced. Constitutively produced means they are always producing. Okay, but these virulence factors are not constitutively produced, which means there should be a condition. Only at that conditions these virulence factors are produced. So bacteria should know, or any pathogen should know, which condition is favorable for colonizing or setting up an infection. And only at those conditions, they will signal, they will take the signal from the environment, and they will result in, there will be a synthesis of virulence factors. Okay, so we will see which different environmental signals are involved and which proteins and which machineries are involved in sensing these signals and then resulting in synthesis of the virulence factors. So, let's take a example of one of the very well known disease, cholera. So, cholera is caused by Vibrio cholerae. It is upon infection, which means upon entry, this Vibrio cholerae in the intestine, it passes the mucus layer. Okay, so in intestine, there is mucus layer, and after that mucus layer, there is epithelial cells. Okay, so this swims through the mucus layer and goes to the epithelial cell and establish itself there with the help of type 4 pili. Okay, the type 4 pili is helpful for attachment to the epithelial cells. Okay, and these type 4 pili are also known as TCP, that is toxin co-regulated pillars. Okay, and then it upon establishing itself on the epithelial cell, it colonizes. Okay, and after a particular number of the number of organisms reached, it results in different symptoms such as watery diarrhea. So there is a loss of 10 to 20 liters of fluid from the body, and there is a severe dehydration because of water loss, and there is a loss of electrolyte. And because of loss of electrolytes and dehydration, the death rate of this cholera is very high, which is 60% of the infected people can die of Vibrio cholera. So what causes this diarrhea? Okay, so this water loss or this watery diarrhea, what causes this watery diarrhea is the toxin which is produced by Vibrio cholera. The name of toxin is cholera toxin. Okay, so it is a basically protein consisting of 6 subunits, 1 A subunit and 5 B subunits. Okay, it is consisting of these 6 subunits, and it is encoded by CTXAB operon. This operon is found not in Vibrio cholerae but on a lysogenic phage. So this phage, name of the phage is CTX lysogenic phage, which means if a Vibrio cholera, cell of Vibrio cholera is not infected with this CTX lysogenic phage, then it cannot result in cholera. Okay, it cannot develop it cannot cause cholera. But if that strain or that cell has a CTX lysogenic phage, only then it will establish or it will cause cholera, because this CTX lysogenic phage contains a CTX operon in its genome, and this CTX AB operon is responsible for production of these subunit, that is cholera toxin subunits. Okay, so how this CTX AB operon is regulated, we will see. So here there is a transcription regulatory protein known as Tox R. This protein regulates the CTX AB operon. Okay, and in the there is a Tox R regulon. In Tox R regulon, there is a CTX AB operon. So not only toxin is produced, but there are n number of different genes which are present in Tox R regulon, which help in establishing or developing the infection. Okay, so this Tox R regulon is stimulated by Tox R protein. Okay, so this Tox R protein, when it gets activated, it will result in transcription of this Tox R regulon. So in the Tox R regulon, there is also a CTX AB operon. So we will see what are the different what environmental conditions this Tox R protein gets activated, and then it results in transcription of CTX AB operon. Okay, so here different studies have been done and different conditions have been studied. So in the intestine, there are different conditions such as temperature, osmolarity, pH, presence of different salts or other substances. So exactly which stimulus influences the Tox R activity, which means Tox R protein is due to which environmental signal it gets activated. Okay, so there were studies in which they studied different condition, of which I have taken these 3 or 4 examples, where they cultivated Vibrio cholerae pure culture at temperature 37 degrees Celsius, but this they could see the decreased or lower toxin production. Okay, so which means the temperature 37 temperature is not affecting the activity of Tox R. Okay, then they studied the production or activity of Tox R in presence of low pH. There was increased activity of Tox R, but in the intestine pH is not low, pH is alkaline, that is high pH. So these two conditions are not the stimuli for influencing the Tox R activity, correct? Because temperature 37 in the intestine, there is a 37 temperature, then it should increase the toxin production, but it is not increasing. So which means temperature is not a factor, and low pH is also not a factor, because low pH is not there in the intestine. So there are other conditions which were studied, like osmolarity conditions and presence of amino acids. So these osmolarity conditions were similar to the osmolarity conditions of mucus, because above the epithelial cell there is a mucus layer. So there is a different osmolarity condition for the attached Vibrio cholerae cells. And presence of amino acids, so the in presence of some amino acids which are present in mucus secretion, originally which are present in mucus secretion, those amino acids were taken. So it was observed that there was increased activity of Tox R, and because of which there is a increased toxin production, which means these two conditions, osmolarity condition and presence of amino acids, are the stimuli which help or which influence the Tox R activity and result in increased toxin production. Okay, so these were the environmental signals which were responsible for increased toxin production. Okay, so now let's see what is the Tox R protein and what is its role. Okay, here it's a inner membrane protein. Okay, so and it is a bifunctional protein, which means it is in the inner membrane and it performs two functions. First function is it senses the environmental signal. So the whatever signals are coming from the environment, okay, it will sense the environmental signal, and it will activate transcription of 30 to 40 genes in the Tox R regulon. So which means it senses the signal and it activates the transcription of Tox R regulon. So Tox R regulon is consisting of 30 to 40 genes, different genes which help in colonization, toxin production and survival in the host. Okay, and these genes which are in the ToxR regulon are known as ToxR activated genes, or we can call acronym as TAG, ToxR activated genes. Okay, so let's see how this ToxR actually activating the regulon and the their regulatory pathway. Let's see what are the different genes which are present in the ToxR regulon. Okay, CTX AB operon is present in the ToxR regulon. This operon produces the toxin subunits, that is cholera toxin subunits. Okay, then there is another gene, that is TCP A. It is a gene which produces protein. That protein is a major subunit of pilus. Pilus is very important for the attachment before the producing these toxin subunits, because unless and until the microorganisms attaches to a epithelial cell, it will not produce the toxin. So first, it is very important to produce pilus. So that gene for that pilus is also is in the ToxR regulon. Okay. Now another genes which are present are gene for pilus assembly and transport. Okay. So that these subunits are produced, then these subunits needs to be transported to the cell surface, and there should be assembly. So all the proteins and genes, enzymes which are all required for these activities will be encoded by the ToxR regulon. After that, there is a one ToxT gene and other genes. Okay, so ToxT gene is also present in the ToxR regulon, and there are other various genes. So let's see how ToxR regulates these different genes. Okay, now as you can see, this ToxR regulates CTXAB operon directly, which means it binds to the promoter of CTXAB operon, and it results in transcription of CTXAB operon and production of thereby toxin subunits. But other genes in the ToxR regulon are regulated by ToxR only, but they are regulated indirectly. So how it is indirectly regulated, let's see. This ToxR protein, which is activated due to environmental signal, it will result in increased transcription of this ToxT gene, which is present in the ToxR regulon. Now, this ToxT gene produces ToxT protein, and this ToxT protein activates the transcription of all other genes which are present in ToxR regulon. So, it is clear how ToxR gene regulates other genes indirectly, because it is activating the transcription of ToxT gene, which is leading to production of ToxT protein, and it will now activate the transcription of all these genes, and it is directly activating or regulating the CTXAB operon. Okay, so let's see how this ToxR protein transmit the signal to ToxR regulon. Okay, so as we have seen, in two component signaling system there are two proteins majorly which are involved, kinases and response regulators. Here it is a single protein, but remember it is a bifunctional protein, and it is in the membrane, and C terminal of the protein is in the periplasm and N terminal is in the cytoplasm. So from the periplasm it receives the signal, and then because of activation, now in the N terminal it has a DNA binding domain, so it can bind to promoter sequence of any gene. So once it gets the signal from periplasm to the C terminal, from the N terminal DNA binding domain, it can bind to a promoter sequences of gene and can result in activation of transcription. Okay, it is clear till this. Now let's see how the signal transduction cascade, or how the signal transduction takes place. Okay, so up till now we saw that there is a ToxR protein which gets activated because of environmental signal, but many studies have suggested that there is another protein known as Tox S protein. It is also in the membrane along with the Tox R protein. Here the study suggests that this Tox S protein receives the signal from periplasm, plasmic domain, and then it activates Tox R. Now this activated Tox R will result in activation of CTX abioperon and other tox T gene. Okay, so up till now we saw that this tox R was taking the signal from the environment, but there is another protein, tox S protein, which receives the signal and it activates the tox R, and this is how the environmental signal comes to tox R protein. Okay, and there are other signaling proteins as well, which are known as TCP P protein and TCP H protein. Okay, so this TCP H protein is more like tox S protein, which means this senses the signal from the environment and then it activates the TCP P protein. This TCP protein is like tox R protein. Okay, so now once this TCP protein gets activated, it positively regulates tox T gene. Correct. Tox R gene also positively regulates tox T gene, and tox TCP protein also regulates tox T gene positively. So there are two proteins, tox R and TCPP, which regulate the tox T gene. So there is an increased production of tox T protein. Okay, so let's see how the regulatory pathway looks. Okay, so this is the diagrammatic representation of regulatory pathway of tox R regulon. So here you can see this is the cell membrane. Okay, and in the cell membrane there are these four proteins. Okay, signal transducing proteins. So these proteins, one, you know, tox R protein, there is tox S protein, it is represented directly tox RS. Okay, there are more two proteins, TCP protein and TCP H protein. Okay, so these are represented like this. Now what happens when the environmental signal comes? This tox S protein will sense the signal and it will activate this tox R protein. This tox R protein will do what? Upon activation, it will positively regulate the tox T gene, and tox T gene, when gets regulated, transcribed, it produces tox T protein. This tox T protein regulates what? Tox R regulon. Tox R regulon is made up of CTX operon and other proteins and other operons. So the another operon is TCP operon. Okay, now this CTX operon encodes cholera toxin, and this TCP operon has pilus production and other n number of genes. Okay, which are required for pilus production, assembly and etc. For survival, there are genes which are also positively regulated by tox T, and this TCP operon also has a gene for tox T, which results in production of tox T. Okay, so this tox T, so more tox T, more positive regulation of TCP operon and CTX operon. Okay, up till this now it is clear. Now this tox R protein upon activation also directly activates the CTX operon, so it is also positively regulating CTX operon, and tox T protein is also positively regulating CTX operon. There is TCP PH. Okay, TCP P, so the signal comes to the TCP H protein, it activates TCP P. This activated TCP P will positively regulate tox T genes. Tox T gene will produce tox T protein. Now this tox T protein can regulate all the genes in the tox R regulon. So these genes will be TCP operon, CTX operon, likewise. So the presence of TCPP and tox R in the activated state, these two proteins in activated state give the optimal activation of tox T genes, which results in production of cholera toxin and all the other virulence components which help in pathogenicity of cholera, Vibrio cholerae, to establish the cholera. Okay, so I hope up till this it is clear. Thank you.